stage, typically your host of these deck lunches, Miss Becki Hyde.
That's a way better introduction than I give for anybody. I'm so sorry to all of you that have given talks and I didn't have an air horn to introduce you with. Welcome. Welcome to the deck. Welcome to deck lunch. I'm your happy host, Becki Hyde. Today, it's story time. I had a lot of fun making this presentation. I hope it shows. So, I'm Becki. I'm a product manager here in the Digital Experience Center, and today I'm going to talk about an activity that a lot of you are probably very familiar with, story writing. How many of you write stories or have written stories at some point in your career? Hands? Yeah, and I bet you all wrote them differently, which is totally fine. Totally fine. So, all of the opinions in this presentation are my own, and I reserve the right to change my opinion based on new evidence. We have a saying here in the deck, strong opinions, lightly held. And that's something that I believe in very much. I will take a stance, and I will stand for it passionately. Those of you who know me or have worked with me know that I will hop up on a soapbox at a moment's notice. However, in the face of new information, I will change that opinion. So, and that's something we believe very strongly in, and that applies to this presentation as well. So I'll talk about some things today, if you disagree, feel free to wave a hand and let's talk about it, because that's how we all get better. But for now, these are my thoughts on user stories. So, let's start with a little history on user stories and where they came from. Once upon a time, if you wanted to build software, someone with a bunch of technical expertise would write functional requirements. They used a lot of big words to describe a thing that should be built by engineers. Luckily, I never had to write this kind of documentation, but some of you are probably familiar. Then, in 1999, when people were still worried about Y2K, so go back. Verified time to go back. Let's go way back. The time machine to 1999. A gentleman, which feels like it was like 10 years ago, right? 1999, that was like 10 years ago. It was not. A gentleman named Kent Beck published a book called Extreme Programming Explained. And that's Kent pointing at his name. There's a lot of pictures on Google of Kent Beck doing this. So I'm not the only one who liked this image. In this book, which is awesome and should be read by everyone, Mr. Beck puts forth the concept of user stories. He describes a story as a chunk of functionality that is of value to the customer. So we were doing functional requirements, which were just a way of describing something that we already assumed that we would build. And Kent Beck is saying, let's break it up into these chunks that we can deliver individually that have value to the customer. Goal, he said, was to break up the system so it could be delivered in pieces that can be discussed by the customer and the developers. The customer in this case is a business person who's paying for the software, so they don't speak tech. So we write a user story that lets us talk about the thing that we're going to build with an engineer in a way that everybody can understand. Cool. His idea of a user story was designed to support a particular process for software development, quality stream programming, which we do here at the deck to this day. Kent said, the shorter the story, the better, which is an idea I can totally get behind. And the idea being that the story should sum up, in very few words, a small piece of functionality. Not go into super great detail, but to capture the essence of what should be built. He was driving at making things more agile, right? Stream programming is a way to go fast and face of uncertainty, and user stories are a part of that. So, Kent Beck's idea of user stories describe the intent, but not a specific format necessarily. In 2001, Connextra proposed that user stories should have a form that looks like this. So as a role, I want goal or desire, so that benefit. Looks familiar, right? We're still doing this today. This style was popularized by Mike Kahn in the book User Stories Applied, which came out in 2004. So this is still like a long time ago. We are still writing stories to this day, this way, 17 years later, from when Kent Beck first proposed the idea. That's a long time for something to persist in software development land where everything changes daily. So now that we've had some history lesson, I want to take a brief detour and identify some assumptions that I'll be operating under for the purposes of this talk. This will save me from over-qualifying all of my statements throughout in a series of increasingly obnoxious your mileage may vary statements. Assumption number one, I assume that everyone that you need to deliver a story, whatever that story looks like, is on your team. That means you attend the same meetings, you work together, and you're accountable to one another. You may define a team in many different ways. It may be reporting structure, it may be where you sit, it may be the products that you work on. But the general idea is that you're all driving at the same goal, right? If you pass off work from one role to another and fight about the person before you impacting your timeline, I'm very sorry for you. That sucks. And you might struggle to apply some of the concepts that I'm going to talk about today. Assumption number two, I assume your team communicates openly. So this means you have actual conversations with one another. Email doesn't count. You can be in different locations and communicate openly. You don't have to be co-located. We are here, but I know plenty of teams who are in different time zones and different countries and still communicate openly. It's hard, but possible. But just emailing a weekly status update or having a daily stand-up isn't the kind of communication that is required for the kind of user story that we're talking about. And last but not least, I assume your team is empowered. The way I propose writing stories is not new, but it does rely on a lot of assumptions about how your team conducts other areas of their work, not just the writing of stories. That is to say, the right way to write stories will not solve your team's problems. These assumptions must also stand. So, a sad story. Poorly written stories are more common than you think. You may be writing sad stories without even knowing it. So does this look familiar? As a user, I want a submit button so that I can submit the form. Yeah? It's a story about a user who wants to click a button. Woo! That's simple and clear, right? Just like our user stories and our functional requirements and all of our communication about software development is supposed to be. It's simple, it's clear, it's direct. It's a button. What this really is functional requirements, which is what user stories were not supposed to be. It's nice that you've reiterated the functional requirements twice, in case they didn't catch it the first time. But in this case, your story is just describing what you want built. Why even bother with the user story? Just write the acceptance criteria. Neat. Given I'm on the form page, then I see a submit button. That's way more straightforward than the previous thing, if that's your goal. Or you could make a mock-up and say, build that, which is probably the clearest way to communicate if all you want to communicate is to say, build me this widget, okay? So, we end up writing sad stories like the one that I just showed you for a lot of really understandable reasons. We get wrapped up in writing stories for the wrong reasons altogether. So there's this Twitter account called Guy in Your MFA. This is the guy who was like an English major so he could write poetry to try to impress women and as an excuse for drinking too much whiskey. Sometimes people write things for the wrong reasons. That's why I bring this guy up. Also follow him on Twitter. He's hilarious. He's writing his poetry so the girls can find it laying around on the floor of his apartment. So sensitive. So what are some of the bad reasons that we in technology write sad user stories? As a shortcut, the most exciting part of the Agile Manifesto is the part that says working software over comprehensive documentation. We love this part because comprehensive documentation takes a really long time. It's really boring and nobody wants to do that. So we say, ooh, working software first. We're not going to write any documents. And a user story is a way for us to avoid writing a bunch of documentation. We just write a story. That's so much easier. However, avoiding work is not a good reason to do something. User stories are not intended to sidestep the work of communicating what a chunk of functionality should do. Another reason with good intent that manifests itself in bad user stories is because we're being agile. We're being lean. Look how little we write. We're so lean. By following a process and not understanding the principles behind it, we risk doing the thing for the sake of doing the thing. There are many ways to be agile. The definition of agility is to move quickly and easily. My email is bouncing at me. I'm going to shut that down real quick. That's really irritating. Oh, cool. Just kill my presentation. That's what I want you to do. There we go. Where was I? There are many ways to be agile. The definition of agility is to move quickly and easily. Even the software-specific definition, which is relating to or denoting a method of project management used especially for software development, that is characterized by the division of tasks into short phases of work and frequent reassessment and adaptation of plans. It doesn't say anything about story format. Being agile is not about how you write stories. It's about being agile. Do not confuse understanding of a way of writing a story with an understanding of agile. Knowledge is knowing, a tomato is acquired, wisdom is not putting it in a fruit salad, that sort of thing. And number three, for reasons we write bad stories, human beings love patterns and shortcuts, and form over function is kind of natural for us. We often focus on the process of something rather than the principles, which is natural. Stopping to ask why you're doing something all the time feels slow and repetitive and kind of obnoxious. If I stop to ask why I'm writing every story, it's like, oh, haven't we been over this? We tend to think, I've got this. I know what I'm doing. Following the process is easier, it's faster, it's a shortcut to confidence. I wrote my story the way that Connextra said to back in 2001, so I must be doing it right. Therefore, we get hung up on the as a, I want to, so that, of the user stories, and we stop thinking about what those things are actually supposed to mean. And one more, we're lazy. Sometimes we are just lazy. You know it, I know it. Sometimes we get busy, it's easier to slap together a lazy story than to stop and think about it analytically. So, how do we get this right? We have to stop and do a lot of thinking about what the parts of a user story are actually supposed to do. This first part, as a blank. What is that blank usually? It's like somebody's name, or sometimes it's just user, which, what does that even mean? What this is actually supposed to be is a placeholder for a whole lot of information. Who are you building for? What problem are you solving for them? Who is this person, like, as a person? What do we know about them? We have to put as a user here, it's better to use a name that represents the persona you're building for. This piece of the story is a placeholder for the package of information that the persona represents. Observations, journey maps, other information you've gathered, hopefully you spent whole lot of time really fleshing out a persona. There's a lot of detail in there that you don't want to write over and over again. The name is supposed to stand for that. It's a placeholder for our empathy. So the user's name should call to mind a rich background that informs our work. It shouldn't just be, it's Jane because Jane is a name. And oh, we're building for people, so we're building for Jane. Well, no, Jane should have a job and a series of problems that we're trying to solve for her, and we had spent a whole lot of time figuring that out. and it should all be packed into the ads whoever. Some people are putting forth a different type of story called job stories. What struck me about this was that the proponents of this type of story are saying that removing the persona from the story doesn't take anything away. If removing the user from your story doesn't take anything away, then you don't need a new way to write stories. You need to stop paying lip service to empathy and research. This is about principles, not process. So up here he says, ways to solve a problem, not ways to write a story. I agree with the focus on motivation rather than implementation, but I believe that the problem lies in why you write a story, not how. So I'm saying I don't think we need like, ooh, a new fancy way to write stories. There's nothing wrong with the way. It's making sure we've got good motivations behind our process. So the next part, I want blank. What is the user trying to do? Like in real life, no user wants to push a button, not a UI button anyway. Significant other might want to push your buttons because it gets something out of you that they want, but people don't want to push buttons in software. They want to achieve a goal. So maybe they want to add their information so they can register for a 5K. Or maybe they want to download a PDF of information they're viewing in your application. These are the kinds of things that users want. This part of the story should be small and specific. This is the part that is really easy to get confused with a functional requirement. Don't do it. Think of the user. And then the last part, so that. How does that immediate goal that we talked about in the I want to fit into a larger context? So will downloading a PDF get them closer to completing a big presentation? Will uploading a profile photo, which may have been their I want to, help them represent themselves in an online community? This part of the story likely has nothing to do with software. It's about the world the user lives in, and specifically the world that your persona lives in. So, stories are placeholders for conversations. The purpose of a story is to, in a few words, capture the essence of the world that our software development is meant to fit into. It connects engineers with the people that they're building for, so they can see why. Also, words are confusing. So how will we implement this? It depends on what the meaning of the word is. Talking is better. Have you ever had someone misinterpret something you wrote? Ever happened to you guys once in a while? Yeah. Talking is better. Stories should leave room for a variety of implementations, which fosters questions from your team and discussions about the best path forward, all centered on the user and their problem. If we try to solve everything in the documentation or define everything in the documentation, then people will assume that they know everything there is to know, and I can guarantee that something will be lost in translation. Stories are a tool, not the goal. We should see user stories as a tool to facilitate our work, not the end goal of our work. And stories are just one of many, many ways for us to build a shared understanding. The end.
Questions? Comments?
Almost made a comment about like how I could do a whole other talk on acceptance criteria.
definitely could, but I believe that a user story in the right team and in the right process can stand on its own in the absence of acceptance criteria, and you may not even need acceptance criteria. So if your team is super tight-knit, communicates really well, has a really good shared understanding of the problem, if the stories are appropriately small, and it really is about delivering value to the consumer, then acceptance criteria may actually not matter, because the implementation of the value isn't really the point. Getting to the value is the point. That's a really awesome place to be in, where you don't need acceptance criteria, because it signals a lot of other really cool things about your team, which is that, like, you're really connected to your customer value, and there's a lot of assumptions in there. But a technically user story separate from acceptance criteria.
Can we take a poll? Does anybody write acceptance criteria? Raise your hand if you write acceptance criteria.
Yeah. I mean, we do here, right? Even at the deck, where, you know, I think we have a pretty awesome process. We're all very empowered to make a lot of decisions about the products that we work on. 98% of the time, we're writing acceptance criteria, just because it's easier to test. However, I have worked on a couple of products where sometimes things were moving too fast for acceptance criteria. I believe on the Q project, Jason, correct me if I'm wrong, we had some stories that were just titled. They didn't even have a user story in them. It was just a one-line description. It was like, I don't remember our persona's name, but it's like, Jane gets a water notification. We all knew what that meant. So the story really was just a placeholder for the conversation that we had had. And the only reason it even existed was so that we knew that that's the thing we were doing next, as opposed to Jane gets a step notification.
So can you talk about the confirmation side of things? Can you talk about, you know, essentially the card, the conversation, but the acceptance criteria component and just user stories apply? I would say there's a confirmation. So can you talk about the conversation and ultimately the confirmation that takes place, even if you're not using acceptance?
Yeah, it's in the acceptance of the story. Is that what you're getting at? Yeah. Whether it's like formal acceptance criteria written down and given when then, or functional requirements, or however you write your acceptance criteria, there is a close to the feedback loop, right? So the story captures a whole lot of things. It's a placeholder for a whole lot of things. And then when the story is delivered, the product manager or whomever does acceptance on your team goes back and looks at that and says, oh, here's the software now. Does it do the thing that the story was supposed to do? And yeah, regardless of what the details are, that's a checkpoint. It's the close of that feedback loop between business and engineering, so to speak, on are we delivering the value that we intended to deliver?
Here's a we do. Long off and far ago, like 9 years ago when we started doing this, we had acceptance criteria. And we found in our planning meetings, we spent a lot of time arguing over what the acceptance criteria was. So my whole goal in this is to make the meetings short, 8 meetings. So instead of doing acceptance criteria, we said, why don't we just, because you know, you want to give somebody how do you test this, you put in what's called a testing hint. There's a lot less semantic load in testing hint than acceptance criteria. So it just says, yeah, when you test this, make sure you do this and this and this. So that's, and nowadays, that you, the testing hints, that you wrote a default for that, which was, make sure nothing else is broken.
That should be an assumption of anything.
That's why it's a default. When you create a story, your template just puts that in. It just says, testing hints, make sure nothing.
Yeah, make sure you did your job correctly.
So if you have to write, if you find yourself discussing what the acceptance criteria is, that's a waste of time, because you're going to discuss it again and again and again. So the way is actually, 5 years ago, we actually got to the point where we said, hey, sometimes we get a surprise in the demo, so let's review the story with the product owner before you say it's done. And that lasted about 6 months, and it became a bottleneck. So now we review it every day, continuously, all the time, so that there are no surprises when the story is done. It may change completely from the day you started to the day you ended, because it's a discovery process. So I'm, like Becki, I'm actually more opinionated than Becki is.
Let it be said. There are few people who are. You are.
But acceptance criteria, in my opinion, is a waste of time.
And I would, just to add on to that, think about what really matters. Why are we building software? It's not for the sake of building software. It's for the sake of solving a problem, right? Or hopefully, right? That's exploding. Hopefully, it's to solve a problem. I don't want to work on throwaway stuff. Personally, it's not very, it would make me feel great to go home at the end of the day and be like, man, I delivered a bunch of garbage nobody's going to use today. That's exciting. So if we really are building software to solve a problem, then every piece of software we deliver should be getting at some kind of customer value. And at the end of the day, does it really matter how we got the customer value? We just want the customer value. Arguing about acceptance criteria is like rearranging the deck chairs on the Titanic, right? It doesn't matter if the button is to the left or to the right, or if the header is blue or green. Does the customer care? Does the user care? Does it make any difference in how they solve their problem? If not, then who cares? That's very idealistic. Compliance is a customer, they're one of your users, right? That's in that whole package of conversation and information that goes into writing a story.
I was just going to say, in my experience, while lightweight user stories in this case, and your all's experience, that's great if it works. But for a team in, let's say, a waterfall environment who's now just starting to work in a more agile fashion, and you don't have cross-functional teams, and you've got onshore and offshore, and when you basically are more on the waterfall side of agility, how do you make those incremental improvements? And what I would offer up is, when you have learned behaviors that are very document-driven, and if it's not explicit, I don't do it. Those types of things, if I can't hire and fire those people, then you gotta work within the context of your environment, right? You gotta do whatever is necessary to be successful. But I guess I would just say that what I had success in doing is kind of adopting acceptance criteria and including even things like deploy this all the way up to the end environment. Literally, that was one of my acceptance criteria on all my stories. Why? Because if I didn't say it, they wouldn't do it. Well, what happened over time was they started doing those things automatically. So I didn't have to become an acceptance criteria. So then I could back off of my acceptance criteria and focus more on the conversation. But when you have somebody who doesn't want to work with you per se, you got to do whatever you need to do to be successful.
Yes, and you can also try giving someone nothing, and suddenly they start asking a whole bunch of questions about what the intent was, and then you have that conversation that is really the crux of everything, right? People should just talk to each other. We can't cover all of our bases in a document, no matter how we format the document. And in the absence of any details, suddenly, engineers who were really quiet and never really asked any questions and would only do exactly what you told them to start tapping you on the shoulder and being like, what did you want me to do here? And you go, well, what do you think is the best implementation of this? And then you have that conversation. I really believe in it as a way to, it's a journey. It doesn't happen overnight.
overnight. It doesn't work for everybody, but I think we can get there.
I want to make that.
Matt?
Yeah, you talked about the risk of removing the user from the story and the associated persona and information. How do you keep that from happening as de facto, just as you have 50, 100 stories come through and some of these things get really granular and mentally whatever that persona name is becomes the equivalent of user?
Have designers on your team. Did you set me up for that?
No.
Yeah, if you guys could hear Matt, he was asking like how over time, how do you prevent like mental fatigue of you know, the name Jane becoming not a persona, but just a corollary for a user. If you've been working on something long enough, you should revisit your persona. Just because you validated it 6 months ago doesn't mean it's still valid. Having designers on your team brings those kinds of things to the forefront. If the focus on the consumer is just easier when there's a designer on the team because they're always talking about the user. Like, they're like, but what about Jane? This isn't Jane's problem. Jane doesn't need a PDF. She needs a CSV because this is her job. And like, it's like, oh, okay, yeah, thank you for reminding me that Jane isn't just like a function of the system. Jane is like a human being with a problem. And that's kind of what I was getting at one point when I talked about we get lazy or it's easier to just write the story in a certain way because if we go back and reanalyze everything all the time, it feels repetitive and it's like, oh, didn't we cover this already? Well, yeah, but what has changed in the time since you covered it? And that's something that's a continual struggle for me personally is because once I've figured out a way to do something, I'm like, oh, I know how to do that now. I don't have to think about that anymore. And it gets you into trouble, right? Because you start building in a bunch of assumptions that you don't even realize that you're building. You already spoke, but he is not. Yes?
Story points?
Yeah.
Story points,
yeah, we estimate stories. Relative complexity, just to give a quick rundown of how the deck does it, it's usually like a small, medium, large. Some teams use 1, 2, 3, 1, 3, 5, 8. You can take your pick, but it's only relevant within that team. And it's all about relative to the other stories in the backlog. It's not like, oh, 2 points means 2 days or something like that. It's this thing is twice as complex as this other thing. And we try to keep them really, really small.
If you ever have a situation where somebody says, I need to put a story, we need a story for this, and you look at them and say, that's not a story. For example, we need a technical story.
Well, is it a chore, or is it actually something that the user needs that we just need to translate into user value? So the technical stories are often tech debt masquerading as stories. It either should be folded into a story with actual customer value, and we just invest the time in fixing the tech debt or paying it back, or it's a chore, which is purely technical, but hey, it still needs to happen. This is a fact of life. Things need to be upgraded, updated, et cetera, et cetera. We have to file tickets for things. This is just part of doing our job. So that's a chore. And then there's the third fuzzy category of things like, yeah, okay, I think it's actually a story, but we're just approaching it from the wrong direction. We're approaching it from the solution as opposed to from the problem. So, yes.
Well, outside the deck, you'll sometimes get people that will say, this may have happened to you. We're spending a lot of time on this. We have to charge time to it, so we want something on the board so we can talk about something we're charging time to.
That is a whole different talk.
No, I'm just kidding. Okay.
Yeah, and can you do a form locker too? Yeah, Jen. What is accomplished for the user by clicking that button would be my first question. And maybe an example is, you know, when I click that submit button, what I'm actually doing is submitting a form that I'm like, I'm registering for a 5K. I'm training for the mini, and all I can think about is running right now. So the submit button actually submits my information so that I'm registered for something. So it would be, you know, as Becki, I want to submit my information so that I'm registered for the 5K. Because what I'm, my goal is to submit my information. Because if I don't submit my information, then I don't get my bib and I can't run in the race. And then the way that that affects me, you know, outside of the software is I'm registered for the 5K. So it's never about the UI element. This is really, really common. We write user stories about UI elements as opposed to writing them about user problems that are solved by UI elements. Yeah.
And I would add that developers are very creative. And by keeping them focused on the user's problem, you're kind of leaving the door open for them to engage their creativity, to your earlier point, so that you're not just literally dictating create a submit button. That's too easy. But if you leave that door open, it leaves room for maybe a breakthrough. What if there wasn't a submit button? What if, you know, I don't know
what
the answer is, but there might be some other better way to do it.
Yeah, that's a great point. Technology advances at such a pace. And this has happened to me on several occasions where I had gotten around to even writing acceptance criteria yet, and I had just written the user story that was like, oh, we want to deliver this somehow. And designers hadn't even gotten to making a mock-up of it, but an engineer picks it up and they're like, oh, well, what if we did it this way? And it's like, I never would have thought of that. And if I had told you to just make it a button, you never would have thought of that either, because you're just like, oh, deliver the button. I mean, and we're all that way. If somebody tells you, write a four blocker, you write them a four blocker. If somebody tells you, if somebody says, how's your project going? I want to know how your project's going. Then you can come up with all sorts of ways to have a better conversation than just 50% complete to the thing we talked about 6 months ago.
So you know you've written your story wrong when the developer says, hey, what if we do it this way instead? Then you know that you wrote it wrong.
Yeah. Yeah, then you know you were too prescriptive. Yeah.
This is an example of Amazon, right? So if you write the story correctly, they would say, I mean, if I'm understanding correctly, I want to be able to order more Tide when I'm out so I can wash my clothes, right? Well, that most people say, well, you got to go on, log on the internet to do it. Well, now they're starting shipping people a literal button. You stick on your washing machine and you press that button. So,
yep.
You know, the user story, to your point, that allows the folks answering the solution to come up with something, you know, totally different. Didn't say, I guess in this case, Max, that you are clicking a button, but it's not on the screen. It's actually
right.
A button on your washing machine, on your
software,
refrigerator.
Well, why are we doing what we're doing? Are we building software for the sake of building software? Are we solving problems? Doesn't go anywhere, well, great, we waste our time. So,
All right. Thank you, everyone. We'll see you next week.